really the male birds singing to be attracted to female birds. And that is to make sure that the female birds select them to be the father of their offspring. And so reproductive anatomy and behavior are sexually dimorphic. I already mentioned that birds sing, both males and females often sing, but it's the males that have the more elaborate song that sing more frequently and longer, and the females sing but not as elaborate. And so we call that sexually dimorphic, meaning that there's differences between the two sexes. And when we talk about this kind of thing in class, we always talk about the extremes, right? The male and the female being all organized differently, looking differently, acting differently. But we know that we as a human species have the extremes, but there's also these intermediate forms of us that we don't really cover. And I just wanted to say, I know you're here, but the lectures will really be talking about those extremes. So don't feel left out. I've heard that before, like, this is physiology, you know, we try to organize it, and that makes something that we cut out for the adult. Anyways, so sexually dimorphic behaviors and anatomy make sure that males and females are different. And this is mostly done through the actions of sex hormones, so androgens and estrogens. Androgens are hormones that are masculinized, so those can be testosterone for us. And then the estrogens are what makes us acquire female characteristics. And they act at different times in our development. So we have organizational and activational effects. They can both be covered, triggered by hormones. So we have those organizational effects. That really make sure that the structures and the differences are laid down during development, right? So we all start off, in our case, with an XX or an XY chromosome that will determine which of those characteristics is going to develop. But we all start off with tubes and structures that can be used for males or females, but both sets are there. And it really is the expression of a single gene coming off the Y chromosome that starts the whole process where the gonads, the testes, start to develop. They start making some hormones, and then that further develops the system into the extremes of male and female. But we all start off with the capacity to become either one. And so in utero for us, or in the egg for the little birds, we are already exposed to sex hormones, even though we're just developing babies. And these help build the structures up that later in life are going to help us sexually reproduce. And then the system is kind of quiet for a while, but then when puberty hits and our hormones war their heads, that's when we really start to see those activational effects. And in birds, when mature animals, when mature birds, hit breeding season, we see even then an extra amplification of some of the differences, growth or reduction of structures. And so there we not only have the fact that we as an animal age, but there's also the influence of season that determines what the structures look like. And that's what we'll talk about today. So organizational throughout development, and then activational is really happening later in life. So it's sort of on top, layering on top of the organizational. But here, let's see if this one plays as nicely as the other one does. Another example of a bird singing. So I'm not much of a birder myself, but my husband, when he was doing his PhD, this entire lot is all about birding the elk. Pick this up, they have the list, and you go out and they compete, you see and hear the most different birds. Much of biology nerds. But I do enjoy bird singing. So birds know how to make noise, but they learn how to make their specific song. This is not something that's innate, right? It's not something that their genes are telling them. This is something that they hear as they are developing. So they come out of the egg, they hear the song of their species, they remember it, and then later when the males really start to develop their own song, they try to get their song to mimic what they remember, right? We talked about this in the earlier lectures. So the fact that they learn this sound rather than it being innate is special. We have that, songbirds have that, there's a couple other species that really have this, but most animal sounds are innate. We can take the babies away from their parents, they'll make the same sounds. But songbirds learn, so in most bird species, only the males really sing these elaborate songs. And so bird song is generated by this specialized circuit that we call the song system. I'll repost these slides, but I added the explanation of the different abbreviations. That's not because I want you to remember all these abbreviations, but it's because I don't like just seeing a couple letters and then having to remember. And sometimes it's helpful to see what it means. So we have, what we should take away from this slide is that we have these different pathways and inputs and circuits that together make up the bird song. And so we have this blue pathway, the motor pathway, or what was the other word that I found? The production pathway, motor pathway or production pathway. That's really the one that makes the song. So we have the HVC, that's the one that's going to initiate the song. And it sends information to this nucleus RA, which then tells these neurons that are activating the syrinx, the voice box, voice making area of the bird, to go ahead and move in a certain way so that the song can actually be generated, right? So air has to move in a certain way, we have to change the vibrating areas to change the pitch of the sound. That's all regulated through this blue motor pathway. And the HVZ, or higher vocal center, used to be called something completely different. They just named it based on anatomy. What was it? Ventral something, la-di-da. It doesn't matter. When they figured out that this was involved in singing, they were able to keep the abbreviation and just call it the higher vocal center. And that's what we refer to it right now. So that's really what generates the song. And you can see it takes input from this, was it area L or field L? L. Field L. That is what takes input from the ear. So this is what takes the songs in from the adults of the species that they input to the HVC. And the HVC then sends it on two ways, right? It decides to go sing or not, but it also sends it into the learning circuit. And this is where the song, as it's heard when the bird is young, is stored and remembered, and then this is how the bird tries to reproduce this song that it heard when it was young, later in life when it starts singing. So that's the learning circuit. In the learning circuit, we have this area X, like area 51. We have the L-man. The L-man is really the top dog in this system. So that's the main structure here. And then the HVC is the main structure in the motor pathway. So we see that auditory input plays a role. The motor pathway that actually generates the motions to do the actual singing. And then it gets also input through this L-man location that feeds to the nucleus RA that together with the HVC input then makes the sound, right? So we have something planned, we modulate it with what we learn, and together this brings the output to the actual song that we're making. Yes?
So the songs for the same, like for two male birds from the same species would be different or similar?
They would be very, very similar, especially if they grew up in the same area, hearing the same local dialect of their species song. And that's what they try to emulate. But overall, yes, the songs per species are very similar. But there's local variations, just like we have local dialects in how we speak. So we'll look at two areas, the HVC, the higher vocal center. If you look at it in males, this is a cross-section through a brain that then was stained just to show the cells. There's no particular gene or protein or whatever stained. You're just looking at all of the cells that are present. And you compare the same region of the brain in a female bird. You can see that this area here with these, where the nuclei are denser, the cells are closer together, it looks a little darker, is much bigger in the males than it is in the females. And so this is then an example of this dimorphism where the brains are different. This area is larger in males than it is in females. So this is not unique to birds, right? This relates to bird singing, but in us we also have differences, sexual differences. Like what? How are males and females different? You don't have to name any structures, that might be embarrassing. But let's say height, right? I'm a poor example. I'm a tall girl, right? So the fact that I'm tall by itself doesn't mean that I'm a male. But most of our species, the males are taller than the females, right? Same thing happens here. Most of the males have a larger HVC area than most of the females. But it's all sort of, it's not fixed, it's biology, so there'll be differences, right? There's some females that'll have a bigger HVC than some males, but the average is significantly different between the two. And this difference is even more prominent in this nucleus RA. So here's a zebrafish brain where also the males are the ones that are singing. This darker area here, much larger than the same area in the females. And so again, here we see dimorphism in the brain of these animals and the pathways that are making them sing. So now we can hypothesize how these differences arise, right? And one hypothesis here is that this is caused by different androgen levels during development. So androgens, the hormones that make you show masculine characteristics. What kind of hypothesis is this? Before you answer, I may be able to make a quicker question. This is going back to water. First lecture, second lecture, is this proximate or alternate?
She didn't ask a question. She just said proximate or alternate.
Oh, proximate or alternate about what, though?
Yes, so
we just, whatever she spoke about just before this question.
You didn't talk about anything.
Yes, she did. No. She talked about the birds.
Yes. I think it's talking about zebras. Yes. I think it's alternate. You didn't bring it?
Do you take it out?
Hey, go. Cut it right now.
You guys are doing great.
Before she doesn't believe you. Yeah.
Are there any people that still want to go to heaven?
You just raise your hand.
So most people were saying that this was proximate, and then they were absolutely right. Remember, we said as sort of a general rule, hormones are usually proximate, and this is because it asks things about what's happening in a single individual, in the here and now, or in the single individual as it was developing, right? It doesn't look at the bigger picture of the whole species or over evolution. Or asks us about the how it was beneficial that this exists, right? So this was approximate hypothesis. Excellent. So now we have a hypothesis. How can we test this? How can we test the hypothesis that it's the hormones that are doing it? What is the general idea behind this kind of an experiment, right? We think hormones are the cause. What can we do to the system to test this hypothesis? What do we, yes?
You can either amplify the hormones, or you can also inhibit the hormones. So some sections get more treatment and some get no treatment, like control.
All right, excellent suggestion. We can change the levels of the hormones. So if we think that it's the androgens, then we can either take males and reduce the androgens, or we can take females and give extra androgens to them and see how that changes what they look like. All right, excellent. Then in birds, things are a little trickier because what we think of as androgens or female hormones or male hormones is not quite the same for birds as it is for us. Birds also use genetic sex, but actually in them, it's the males that have two of the same chromosomes. Whereas for us, we have XX for female, XY for male. So in birds, the females actually have the two different sex chromosomes. And they also use estradiol, which in us is definitely a female hormone. But those are all androgens. So the testosterone and this more active form of testosterone and estradiol, all masculinizing, so all androgens. So now we can take female birds and male birds and we can add hormones to the female birds, right? And then see what happens. So we predict that if we raise the androgen levels in females that normally wouldn't see very much of them, that their brain structures would look more like those of their male counterparts. It would masculinize the brain and their behaviors. So we can give those two hormone, E2, estradiol, or the more active form of testosterone, in very young birds, and then let them develop and see what happens. And so what we see happens is this is our control here, the untreated male. We need this because now we have an idea of what a male size would look like. Right, so this is sort of our positive control, the thing we know, and we know that works. And then our negative control here is the untreated female. Because that would tell us what the baseline situation is, the size of that HPC in females. And our experimental treatment here is in the middle. We have females, but we've added hormone to them. And so we see that this structure becomes a lot bigger, right? It's pretty much the size of that in males. And actually, these females often start teaming. So this is really, really cool. Just based in genetics. This is something that happens as these birds are developing and growing and their brain changes. And so you can imagine that this maybe occurs through the growth of the neurons or maybe the neurons making more connections. But actually what we see from these pictures is that this area has more cells after hormone treatment in these females than here. And so this is really the first example that we have that we knew that neurons actually get born in life, that neurons proliferate, okay? So research in birds is not something exotic, it really tells you something basic. So this is very exciting stuff. Your brain changes, and actually we now know that there's this constant replenishment of neurons going on in those areas, and that this is amped up in the males as they develop, and it's amped up seasonally as well. So, and we'll talk about that later. There's an effective season on birds singing, obviously, right? Spring birds are singing in temperate areas, and that actually results in more proliferation of these neurons. Very cool stuff. So, how does estradiol regulate this growth? So this is a picture of a cell that has a bunch of different pathways on it. And what we should remember, estradiol, steroid hormone, made out of cholesterol, so very hydrophobic, and it uses a nuclear hormone receptor, right? And in the case of the steroid hormones, these are sitting in the cytoplasm. They wait until they find their ligand, and then the whole complex goes into the nucleus and drives changes in gene transcription. And they usually recruit some other activators there as well. But we now know, so that's the main take-home message of this picture. We now know that estradiol actually has all these other effects. Some of the effects that we can measure in cells that we treat with this hormone are way too fast. They cannot occur through this mechanism of changes in gene transcription. So even though what we have taught you is still true, we now know that they actually must be membrane receptors for these hormones that bind them and start some signaling cascade. And we know that some of those cascades then mix with the cascades from G-protein-coupled receptors and resulting changes. Sometimes it has an effect in how ion channels behave. And there's also just pathways not even using what we know for this hormone. So what I would like you to remember here is that the main pathway is still changes in gene transcription. But actually, steroid hormones, we now realize, also have much more fast effects through different mechanisms. Right, and that's written out here in the next slide. So the main point is, estradiol diffuses into the cell, and then the receptor and estradiol together go to the nucleus to drive changes in gene transcription. You can imagine that that's going to make a big change for these neurons. But we now also know that we can change neural behavior by affecting ion channels and all these other things. New and exciting stuff, but not quite clear. And this is just to remind you of the epigenetic lectures. Once this complex has gone into the nucleus and sits on the DNA, it actually helps recruit HDAX to relax the DNA, histone acetylases, to relax the DNA and allow for more transcription. So it locally changes the structure of the chromatin to allow for more access of other transcription factors. So, like I said, in temperate zones, reproductive behavior is typically seasonal, right? That makes sense. If we start laying our eggs, in winter, there will not be food for the little birdies coming out. So it makes sense to go ahead and plan it such that when your offspring arrives, you're in the season of abundance. And in our case, that is spring heading into summer. And so we can have cues that we can take from our environment that will tell us when it's the right time to go ahead and mate. And birds sing much more in the spring and early summer, and after that it tapers off. So after that their reproductive behaviors go down. And this is because they have a short incubation time for the eggs. If you are a large animal with a longer incubation time, you might actually take your cues from the darker because you need to have the embryonic development take place all the way before spring hits, and then your child is born and you have the time of plenty. So birds sing in the spring because they can fulfill their offspring growing up to be the next season, the next generation of adults, all in spring and summer. So they take their cues from daylight length. You could also imagine that you could look at temperature, but it's actually the length of day that they take their cues from. Right now, so we're sitting around here, and you can tell even without daylight savings that the days are getting longer pretty quickly, right? So the day length is changing pretty rapidly around here. And so this would be an excellent cue for these birds to change their behavior. So Maybe this is not very aggressive singing, but you know, sparrows are very advanced with this song. So this is another European bird. This one used to be pretty abundant, but then they, protected the magpies, and the magpies like to eat these guys' eggs, so now their population declines. This used to be like the city bird that I would see everywhere. In any case, they're pretty common all around, and you can see here these are all temperate areas. And if you plot how their morphology changes over the year, you can look at the volume of the testicles. And here, so there's another measure put up, the brightness of the male colorations. And you can see that there's definitely seasonal variation, right? Early in the year, the testicles grow a lot in size, and also their colors get a lot brighter. So this is really reproductive season. We talked about the hormones, maybe a little bit sideways, that direct gonadal growth, right? Gonadotropins, and that's really what we literally see happening here. FSH and LH are driving this increase in size of the testicles. So even though these birds are mature, they still change and become hyperactive, and you can tell that by the testicular volume. Really something that often is measured in relation to this kind of research. And so if we look in their brains, so these are all pictures of male birds now. We've done away with comparing them to females. This is another seasonal bird. You can see where it lives, but the point of this slide is here. In spring, the HVC and also this RA nucleus are a lot bigger. Right, so each season this happens again, which probably means that as the daylight shortens, neurons here are dying. And then in the next season, neurons are regenerating. It's this ongoing process of change in the brain that drives the behaviors of the singing. And this is a very busy slide. I added here the words FSH and LH because those are the hormones coming off of the pituitary. This is the axis that we talked about, right? We have the hypothalamus that integrates a bunch of signals. This is part of your brain. So there's neurons here making these different hormones, sending them on to the pituitary, and the pituitary then, yes or no, starts secreting FSH and LH, which will then activate reproductive behaviors and anatomical changes, but you see that it isn't just stuff that happens inside the bird. Photoperiod, meaning how long the day is, has an effect, because daylight length is somehow registered in us. We have a pineal gland that takes in daylight and secretes melatonin when it doesn't see daylight, and in birds, we actually think that there are some light sensors right inside your skull. So not through intake of the eye, you can blind the birds, but they still see the changes in the daylight length because the receptors for the light are somewhere in their skull. And so the levels of melatonin are then changing this thing, gonadotropin inhibiting hormone. We didn't really talk about it, but it's the counterpart of the gonadotropin releasing hormone, right? Whatever this guy activates, this guy pretty much inhibits. And so by regulating this, you have an extra layer of control inside the hypothalamus to drive changes in pituitary hormones. Other things, if males are in the right season and the right daylight length, but there's no females around, the behaviors are not really on display as much, so that really comes into play. And if there's a lot of stress, the glucocorticoids are going to amp up GNIH, which will then inhibit this whole axis. So take home message, it's complicated, and it takes both internal cues, the maturation of the bird and what's going on inside, as well as external cues that have to do with mostly season, but also if the time is right. And then this slide kind of summarizes it. Here's our hormone estradiol. And it has many effects, organizing and activating. So organizing early on in development, but then also as the seasons are changing, activating effects of now we see an extra outgrowth of neurons or more connections made between neurons. This slide, I'm not asking you to memorize. This is really just kind of an overview of things that happen. So it looks like we have quite some time left, and I thought that we could do, let's first ask if there are any questions, and then I'll ask you a question. So since we have some time, I know you guys always like to have practice questions. So I'm going to ask you guys right now, based on today's lecture, can you write up a question? And so I'll make a thing in Canvas where you can submit it. And then I promise I will use at least one of those questions on the final for this subject. How about that? Okay? So you can talk to your neighbors. It may be nice if both of you submitted on Canvas or the three of you submit the same thing. That's okay. I'll start making that right now, and then you guys have already made your first question for the
question. Oh, yeah. She didn't say
it.
I know, but she also didn't say, oh, by the way, if you don't make one, you don't get it. She should have said, I'm going to give you guys an option to make that.